Welcome back for episode 3 in this series of tutorials for PCG. We left off last time with a rule that generates a forest with different trees, rocks, and foliage without overlapping with each other. If you haven't seen the previous one, I recommend watching them before. So today we will see how to sample on something else than the landscape, something asked a lot in the comments in the previous videos. We will also see how we can create subgraphs and how to use them. So for this video, we are going to talk about mesh sampling. If you are on 5.2 preview, there is only the blueprint version of the mesh sampler called mesh 2 points. Underneath, it is using the functionality from GeometryScript. Because GeometryScript is another plugin, to avoid bringing too much dependency with us in the PCG plugin, in the final version of 5.2, there will be a secondary plugin called Procedural Content Generation Framework GeometryScript Interrupt. If you are on the newer version and want to use the mesh sampler, you need to enable it, and this will add a new native node called the mesh sampler, which is a C++ version of the blueprint node with a new sampling method, but we'll come back to it later. Sneak peek on what we are going to do today, a log with mushrooms. So if I drag and drop my subgraph, you can see that I have a log with some mushroom on it. We'll first try to create a single one, then use the graph to create it for one log to spawn multiple ones. Note that this is one step towards procedural assemblies, like the one presented in the State of Unreal demo. For the meshes, I'm still using the Megascans forest undergrowth. It contains the logs and the mushrooms. So you can see the log that I will be using is this one, and I will use these mushrooms. For this part, I recreate a new volume outside of my forest, and I recreate a new PCG graph called log with mushrooms. For this one, we won't use any input yet, and we'll focus on a single point. We'll take the center of our volume. To get our volume, I'll introduce a new node, get actor data. With this node, you can query data from actors. With the actor filter right now, it is self. It means the actor on which the PCG component is attached to. You can change it to parent. If the PCG component is attached to a child actor, it will look for its parent. Root is the parent at the top of the hierarchy. All world actors means that we'll pass all the actors. Might be very slow if there are a lot of them. Original is the same .self. If you are in a non-partitioned volume, we haven't seen partitioned volume yet, but for a partition actor, it means the original volume, not the local one. So we will stick with self today. In the current mode, pass actor components. The output of the node depends on the actor query. In this case, our actor is a PCG volume, so the output would be a volume. If the actor were a spline, it would have been a spline. And the output is a collection. It means if you have multiple spline on your actor, it will return multiple spline. In 5.2, every time we debug an element that is not a set of points, we collapse to points using the default settings. In our case, we have volume, so we will sample points in our volume. If I enable debug, I will see one point. If I increase the size of my volume, set it to 2, we'll still have one cube. Well, not exactly. If I inspect the node, you can see that I have like 36 points, but I don't see them because they are all glued to each other. So if I change my scale method in the debug information to absolute and I scale down the points, let's say to 0.5, then you can see that I have my points there. Cubes are not always the best debug representation, and you can change the mesh that is spawned by the debug. If you have show plugin content, you will be able to see in the point mesh the PCG axis tripod. If I change back my scale method to extent, you will see the tripod. It is very useful to quickly get the transform of one point. But we don't want to sample our volume here. We want to have just a single point. To do so, we can change the mode on our get actor data node. There are a few other modes. Get single points will return the single point. That is what we want. Get data from property can extract a property value from an actor and use it as an attribute. Get data from PCG component allow to get the results of the output node from another PCG component. And get data from PCG component or pass component, it's a combination of the two modes. For our use, we only use get single point. So we have one single point, then we can spawn our mesh. So I will just add a static mesh for a node, and I will add the log. I can disable the debug, and then I can see that I have like a very, very small log there. And it's also not oriented as I want. So let's scale it and rotate it. So you know the drill. We will use transform point. Let's connect it to get actual data and static mesh pointer. And in this case, we want it to be flat. So we'll rotate it like to 85 degrees, something like this. So have something flat. Then we can obviously add some random transformation for the rotation. We will use absolute rotation. It means that we discard completely the rotation from our input points. And we will do the same for the scale. We'll set absolute scale to ignore the scale from the input point. And we'll put the scale to 15. So now if we are debugging our bounds, you can see that it's way too big. I don't even see it. If I zoom back, you can see that my bounds are enormous there. So let's scale it down. So we'll add a new bounds modifier. Plug it between getActorData and transform point. In this case, we will use the set to completely override the bounds from the input points. And then for the bounds mean, I will say -0.4, -0.40, and then bounds max 4, 4, and 30. And now our bounds are matching the mesh. We'll see in a future video how we can do it automatically. In the meantime, we do it by hand. Also, we want to make sure that with the scaling, if we have multiple input points, that we don't have overlaps. So just to be sure, I will add a self-pruning node between the transform point and the static mesh border. So we'll disable the debug, and now we have a lock with the right bounds and the right transform. I will also reorganize the graph. Note that in this case, I will use the mesh pointer instead of the mesh to point, since it's native, so it's faster, but most options are analog with mesh to point. So we are going to introduce our mesh handler. So I have an error because I don't have any mesh that is provided. If you have errors or if you don't see exactly what you expect it to be, we usually log errors. In the final version of 5.2, you will have the error directly onto the node, but you can also find it into window, log capture, and you will have the error listed there. And if you double click, it will lead you to the node. Here we have an error because I don't have any mesh selected. So let's add our log. And if I press debug, I have nothing. But if I enable the inspection, you can see that I have like 10,000 points. We have some points, but look at the position. You can see that's very, very close to the origin. So mesh handler will generate points in the mesh local reference, and we need to move those points into the point cloud reference. And to do so, we're going to use another node called copy points. So if I disable the mesh handler, what we want to do is we want to copy those points that were sampled from the log into our target point cloud. And in our case, the target is just a single point where we spawn the log. So if I debug there, you can see that I have a lot of points, but it's not very clear with the cube. So let's bring back our tripod. There are multiple options on the mesh sampler. By default, it will generate 1 point per triangle. You can decide to use 1 point per vertex, or only on the mesh sampler, you have access to Poisson sampling. You also have the option to voxelize the mesh first and choose the voxel size. You can play with it a bit if you want to. So in my example, I will just skip on the default case with all the points. So we have way too many points. We need to do some filtering. One way to filter our points is to use normal to density. Connect it there. We disable the copying point there. Enable the debug on normal to density, and you can see that I have different color appearing. I go back to scale method, absolute, let's say 0.1, or even smaller, 0.01. All my points on my log have different color. The one that are on the top are white, it means that they have a high density, and the one on the bottom are black, it means that they have a low density. It will compute the dot product between the reference normal, by default it's up, and the point normal, and store the result in the density. So after that, we can filter very high density to only keep points that will be on the top of our mesh, and to do so, we will use the density filter. So if I connect it, disable the debug on normal to density, re-enable on density filter, reset the point scale of the debug very small. You can see that we have already less point. If I put it very high, like 0.9, you can see that I have only points that are really on the top of the log, and I have nothing below. The combo normal to density and density filter is a powerful tool to filter points, and it can also be used to filter points that would be on the slope, too steep on the landscape, for example. So we had before 10,000 points, and now we have like 900. But it's still way too much. We will add more randomness by picking random points in this set. And we will reuse the same trick with a density filter. But this time, the density will be set randomly instead of the normal. This can be achieved with density noise and density filter. So density noise will just assign a random density between the range that we set, so 0 and 1 in this case. And if I enable debug, so if I put it absolute, I still have small points. You can see that all my points have a random density now. You can play with the seed, and you can see that it will produce different results. And to filter, we'll add a density filter. Let's say 0.8. And we can debug with the tripod to see all points. So we have like 182. So now that we have our points filtered, we will do the same as our foliage with a combo of transform points, bounds modifier, and self-pruning to adapt our points to the mushroom mesh. So in this case, I already have the values set, so I would just like them. So we add a transform point. As we said, we wanted to have a random rotation on Z. Our scale will be like 0.2, 0.3, because the mushrooms are much smaller. Then we can add the bounds modifier. In this case, it's like 0.4, 0.9. It's numbers already computed before. And then of course, we don't want overlapping, so we just do self-pruning. And now you can see that I have points that are scattered on my log. And I have a reasonable number of points. How many? It's like 24. And now we can add our mushrooms. So we'll just add a static mesh panner. And then I will just stick my mushroom there. White mushrooms. I will add, let's say this one. I will add like 3 of them. Disable to debug. And then we have our log with mushrooms. They feel a bit floaty. So to solve that, I will just, for the transform points, perhaps give it a small translation alter Z. Yeah. Better like this. We have our log with some mushrooms. And with that, you have a PCG asset to spawn a log. And I go back to my content browser. I can drag and drop a log, and I have random logs with random position of mushrooms on it. So this is the first attempt to do some PCG assets. All right, final touch. We have a graph that is able to generate a log at every point we give it. So let's combine this graph with the forest that we had. So if I go back to my previous forest graph, I will do the same thing than the rock. I will just take this surface sampler, duplicate it. I will change the seed to have a different sampling. Then we connect the landscape height, and if I debug it, you can see that I have another sampling there. And then what I will do is I will add a subgraph, and we'll just use log with mushrooms. but we have nothing here. It's because the input node is not connected. If I go back to log with mushrooms, I will just remove this one and connect the input, and bam, I have logs there. Of course, what is interesting is to get the value back from the log, so I will just put it back into the output. If I save, you can see that I have logs everywhere, but they are still intersecting with the foliage. So what I will do is I will go back to my forest. I will just add a comment for... And the output of our subgraph are the position of the logs. So we want it to be excluded from the foliage too. And then you have your foliage that excludes the logs. Unfortunately, we can see that we will still have collisions with the trees and the rocks. So we need to be able to provide our subgraph with the exclusion points. But what we can do is add custom pins to subgraph. So if I double click on my subgraph, it will bring me back to my subgraph. Then I could go to the input node and you can see that you have custom pins there. If I add a new one, I want to have excluded points. Since we are only dealing with points, we can set it to point type. And then what we want is before the spawning, we want to exclude it. So we want to add a difference there. So I want to remove the points that we have from our input node. And we want to exclude the trees and rocks. And then spawn it. Of course, we still have this because we didn't plug anything there. So if I go back to my forest, you can see that the pin has appeared. And then I can plug it the difference. So I want to remove my trees. And then I can remove my rock. And of course, I forgot to change the density function to minimum to binary. And then you can see that now my logs are now not colliding with the trees. And press play. I have no logs with mushrooms on it, and they are not colliding with either rocks, trees, or foliage. And then you have it. We added a procedurally generated asset, a log with some mushrooms on it. And that concludes our third episode, which was a bit dense, lots of new concepts to introduce. We'll have something more relaxing on the next episode, since we are going to introduce splines. I'm planning to use all we have seen with so far sampling, but using spline sampling instead. Until then, have fun with the plugin. Take care.